Welcome, friends. I'm very happy to see you. I'm very happy to be back in Northern California once again. Many of you, I notice, have not seen me physically earlier. Some of you have seen me otherwise, but not in this way. So I'm very happy I can introduce myself and tell you what is the purpose of my coming here. I am a disciple of a great master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh, and I am sharing his teachings here. He predicted many years ago, especially I heard him say that in 1937, I was 11 years old, he predicted that the axis of spirituality will shift to the West and localize itself in a very big way in the United States of America. He said this in the presence of an American disciple, Dr. Julian Johnson. I happened to be there. He wrote some letters in the same year, in 1937, to his disciples in the United States, that the spiritual path will be coming to your country. And he gave a reason. He said the reason is that most of the great masters on the true path to our true home, to which we belong, have come in the East and the Middle East. And people in the West, since they discovered the new territories and new countries, have been building up affluence and wealth, physical wealth. They have achieved the goal of creating a lot of physical wealth, but they are not satisfied. Many are depressed, many are lonely, many feel cut off from something real, and many are seeking for something beyond what they have got. What they are seeking is spiritual truth, a journey to their true home, which nobody has explained to them. On the other hand, the East, especially big countries like China and India, which produced many masters, will now shift over to getting what they lacked, physical wealth. So this shift will be that they will now strive, the Eastern countries will strive to be rich in physical terms, and the West will try to be rich in spiritual terms. This was a very interesting statement he made. And he made it many times. So I was very happy to hear that. I had a nice job in India. And when I retired from my job with the government, they offered me a still better job, the governorship of a state, a member of a planning board, which was a cabinet-like position for me. But I said that is not what I would like to see after retirement. I'd like to go and have a ringside seat in that country where the big spiritual show is going to take place. And that's why I came here, and I'm sitting on a ringside seat and watching his prophecy come true. And more people in the West are now seeking the very truth that we were able to get from several masters in the East. I am here to share the teachings of the great master and what they can do for us. There are a few fundamental questions which I asked when I was young and people ask me today. All the religions say that the creative power, God, whatever name you give to the creative power, is inside us and has to be found by ourselves inside. If that is true, why do we need the intervention of a third party, an outside person, to help us find something that is inside us? Why do we need an intermediary? If the truth is inside us, God is inside us, then why are we not just finding it inside us? Why do we need an outside party? The answer is very interesting, but very accurate. The answer is that all our search, when we are in a physical body with a mind, is done by the mind. And we think that the one who thinks is ourself. It's a very big error. It's an error we have all fallen into. And even philosophers have thought that because we can think, that thinking being is ourself. It is not. It's not easy to find that out. Because when we want to find out, we again use thinking. We have no other means to discover anything except by the use of our mind, except by the use of our intellect, except by the use of our thinking process. And thinking process confines us to the limitations that can be with the mind. Can you hear me now?
No.
Not yet. Okay, now we can. It works. The progress we have made also includes this progress. See? We have a limitation in our seeking, in our searching. Very big limitation which we can't even see. The limitation is that we cannot seek except with our mind. And mind has its barriers. Mind cannot go beyond what is not within time and space. That means mind takes time and space to be a given premise which you cannot cross. No thought can take place except with time and space. The mind creates and functions only in time and space. Our true home and the creative power lies beyond that. There is no way that the mind can find something that lies beyond its own capacity. And yet there are things that can go beyond the capacity of the mind. The spiritual path is one of those paths which goes beyond the mind and cannot be discovered by the mind. A very big limitation. Why is that? Because if we examine our own life, we'll notice that there are moments when we think and there are moments when we know something without thinking. People give different names to that awareness which comes without thinking. Some call it intuition, some call it gut feeling. Some call it just inner voice. People give different names to something that happens which gives us awareness of something which is not consistent sometimes with what the mind is thinking. Some feeling comes, we have to go somewhere. The mind says no. Where's the other feeling coming from? Actually, our consciousness is made up of several things. When we understand the nature of our consciousness, what are the building blocks that make our consciousness, then we realize what it is that is beyond the mind. Our consciousness, can you still hear me? I think there's some problem. Okay. We have our experience of this physical world. Examine carefully. We have an experience of a physical world which we believe has been existing for billions of years. The entire experience of the physical world is coming to us through our sense perceptions, 5 sense perceptions. You cut these 5 perceptions out, there is no experience at all. There is no world at all. There is no creation at all. Do you see the limitation? That the entire experience of the entire world we have is based upon perception, created by these perceptions built into our sense organs. We may have thinking based upon something that is not being perceived here. Let us take the mental perception. Our mental perception also comes from the sensory perceptions. They gather together and all the input is from sensory perception. In fact, that is our world. Our perception is our world. That is why the consciousness in us is gathering the information of a physical world through physical sense perceptions. Do these physical perceptions account for all our consciousness? No. I remember one master in India is talking to another man who is a journalist. A journalist is asking him that, why do you think there is something else other than our sense perceptions? He said, you have your eyes open and you can see me. That is your vision, one of the perceptions, one of the sense perceptions. Now close your eyes. Am I still there? Yes, you are still there. Is it memory or you feel I am there? No, you're actually there. How do you know if the eyes were the only one to tell us who is there? There's something else in us. Okay, that's not enough. People have dreams at night. We see in dreams. Are the same eyes seeing or some other eyes? We imagine things. We can imagine something visual. Are these eyes imagining? Another eye. Does the mind have other eyes that it can see? Does imagination come from somewhere else? The truth is that the sense perceptions, when they are built into the human body, they appear to be physical sense perceptions. But they operate without it also. Imagination, dreams, our knowledge of what is happening without seeing, without using these perceptions, still continues. But that is not all. By a process of meditation, meditating upon your own self, by withdrawing your attention to your own self from where you are thinking, from where your mind is, you can become unaware of the physical body and still all your perceptions will be intact. That is what is creating these perceptions in the dreams and in imagination. It's not coming from nowhere. The fact is we have sense perceptions independent of a physical body. The organs of the physical body are picking up the power to perceive from the inner sense perceptions. And this can be found out very easily through a process which we call simple meditation at the third eye center behind the eyes. A lot of masters have recommended that. You want to find out if there is something more in you than what you are seeing here? Yes, just put your attention on your own self. The third eye center is called the third eye center because it is behind two eyes. It is like a third eye. It is not something unusual. Even when we are using two eyes, the way we see one image with two eyes is the same. We can go to a 3D cinema nowadays and they give you special glasses to wear and they convert two images into one image and things look like they are three-dimensional, they're coming near us. These two eyes see two pictures. We don't see two pictures. Without glasses, with these eyes, where are we seeing one picture? Where are we combining the two pictures to create the distance? Right here. We are combining behind these eyes at a common point, just behind, like these two fingers where the two eyes, where they meet, is this distance behind where we are actually seeing even now. That's the only place where we combine the two images of the two eyes and see one image. That is the third eye center. There's no place to discover. Some people say, I have been doing meditation for a long time. I cannot find my third eye center. I said, you are at third eye center all the time when you are awake. You can't go anywhere else. Third eye center is from where we operate in wakeful state. Other states we lose that sense. We go to sleep, we are not even aware of our body, but we are not at the third eye center. We go down. That also can be tested. When we go to sleep, the third eye center, which now appears to be behind these eyes, that we are looking at things from behind the eyes, that itself shifts. To test this out, tonight, when you're feeling sleepy and about to sleep, you know you can touch your eyes with your eyes closed, with your hands, very easily. Try to touch your eyes when you're sleepy, and you will touch your nose, and you will think you're touching your eyes. Because you're still awake, not completely asleep. Some yogis have a yogic practice by which they can retain some of their memory of wakeful state when they're going into deeper sleep, and they know that it can be even further down. When you're dreaming, it goes into the throat center. And when you wake up, it comes back to third eye center. The wakeful state itself is connected with where we operate from. What is in the third eye center? The third eye center contains our self, true self. The only self is at the third eye center. What we have to discover about the creator, you first discover about yourself. The self is sitting right now inside our head at the third eye center. By a simple meditational process, which means putting your attention at the third eye center. Why attention? Because if you examine the nature of attention, which is a very essential part of use of application of consciousness, attention is what creates our experience of the world. You withdraw attention, the things disappear. You can have a simple test. We go to a musical festival, an orchestra, several musical instruments are playing there, and you say, I like the drums better. Put your attention on the drums become louder, and other instruments become weaker. Put more attention on the drums, you can only hear the drums and nothing else. How can attention do that? Because it's the attention that's picking up all our perceptions. And that's a great ability. That means if we put attention on something, we can concentrate it at that point. That's the greatest gift given to us as human beings, the power to concentrate our attention wherever we like. We read books, we put attention on the book, we understand what the book is saying. Sometimes we are so much involved in it, we don't know who's standing next to us, who is anybody else. We don't even know where we are. We can put so much attention. It's the same attention that we can put on our own self at the third eye center. It looks difficult because we have not done it. No other reason. We have lived our life placing our attention on outside things, outside experiences. All our life, we have been trained like that. A newborn baby is coming. We see in the eyes of the baby, little infant, baby thinking something. We don't know what it's thinking. Can't speak. We can't understand. And then we try to draw the attention of the baby. We play with jiggles and dolls and so on. And gradually, the baby grows up that the entire attention is used for outside experiences. We lose touch with what is inside. It's just a matter of habit we have acquired, that attention has always to be placed on something outside of ourselves. We don't know what is inside the head. We have no idea. It must be something, just a mass of brain and flesh and bones and whatever it is, just like the rest of the body. We have no idea that our whole wakeful experience is taking place from the head, from behind the eyes. There must be something more than that. When people try to put attention inside, it's a very difficult thing because they are used to putting attention outside. They try to make an outside inside their head. And I tell you how. People meditate for 30, 40 years, they tell me. I said, how do you meditate? We close our eyes and then we look at ourselves. If you look at something, it's not yourself. That means we don't care. We think because our eyes are closed, we have gone inside our head. Of course not. We are still trying to see with the same eyes, and they are closed, we can't see outside. So what we imagine, we think is inside. That is not true. This is the key of good meditation, that instead of focusing attention on anything, which always takes us out, we will draw attention to ourselves. Big difference between focusing attention and withdrawing attention. And people have missed this point, and for years they have not followed this point, that the true meditation, the true experience of meditation comes when you withdraw attention and not focus attention on anything. People have to imagine we must be something small sitting inside, and we look at that person sitting inside. That must be ourself. Don't we realize that if we can see something, then we are the one who is seeing and not what we are seeing? But we make the big mistake. We make something a picture of ourselves. Now I'll tell you another secret, that when we think we are seeing ourselves sitting in the third eye center, we are not even seeing inside our head, but outside. And I'll tell you how. Again, little experiment. You close your eyes and you imagine that you are sitting inside the head. Then bring your hands to your eyes slowly. And when you bring them, you'll feel your reach the point where you see the image of yourself. And you will have crossed that by the time you touch your, even the images outside of your body. We are making external images and thinking we are meditating at the third eye center. Big mistake. And you can keep on doing it for a whole lifetime and get no concentration of attention on yourself at all. Withdrawal of attention is something different we haven't practiced. When we start practicing withdrawal of attention means put attention on wherever you are, not to see something, but to be aware of where you are. Where are you seeing from? Where are you operating from? What are you doing there? What the self is doing. No matter what form of self you have, it's still conscious self. So this is a very important part which we miss, and that is why not too many people have actually had experiences of their own self through meditation. But if you do meditation correctly, which means withdraw your attention to your own self, wherever you feel it is, because no matter what, when you are awake in the human body, you are at the third eye center. You're not to be searched some point or to be searched somewhere. You're already there. You have to just withdraw your attention to where you already are. With eyes closed, it helps. With closed ears, it helps. Outside distraction don't disturb you. But the point is that you have to withdraw attention. I had this problem for several years after initiation by Great Master. So I went to him and I said, why do I have this problem that I can't imagine where I am, and I can imagine making a picture of myself? He gave me a little experiment. He said, raise your hand, like put a finger on top. Don't see it. Just above your head, which I did. And he said, can you imagine, just imagination, can you imagine you're sitting up there? Think you are sitting up there. I said, I can imagine that. That I am not here, I'm sitting up there. He says, now bring it down. Are you still there? Yes. Are you still there? Yes. Jump in. I jumped in, I knew where I was. But it was just a way of explaining. You have to know where you are, not to see yourself. When you try to see yourself, then you move away from where you are, no matter how close you are. So just minor tip I'm giving you, but very important one, that when you withdraw your attention and hold it there for a reasonable time, which with practice will be 0 seconds, it will be instant when you want to do it, because it will be practice. If you are there, you will find that you will be unaware of the physical body. You will be unaware of a physical universe, but you will be aware of another universe that opens up just by being there. Just like this universe has opened up by using sense perception in the physical body, a physical world comes into being. You withdraw your attention, all sense perceptions are intact. you can see very clearly. You can't see very clearly if you use sense perception through the eyes. I am getting old, I have to use lenses, I have to use something to be able to read or see. I can read 20-20 even sharper with the inner eyes because there is no obstruction. Physical body has created certain obstruction to the use of our sense perception. When you are there, all sense perceptions open up completely. Whose sense perceptions are they? Yours, the self, nobody else. It's not somebody else coming and doing that, it's your own self opening up to something. And because you can see so clearly, then you look at yourself with those eyes, inner eyes. Once you are there, not looking at something else, but looking at your own self in which the perceptions are, you'll find you still have a body. You still have a body very similar to this. And when you try to see how hard the body is, does it still have the same bones? Looks like it has, but it has no matter in it. The shape, the experience of the inner body is being created by the same sense perceptions which are really creating the experience of the three-dimensional physical reality outside. And when you experience that, that you know that that is the inner self that you have, that has all sense perceptions. We sometimes call it the astral body, the sensory body. Oh, different names have been given. Some people say that's the real, some people call it the soul, that we have discovered our soul, the soul is inside the body. It also has the mind, the same mind. The mind has not changed. Your life has not changed. Nothing has changed except that you are now unaware of a physical body and you are aware of something inside which has all mind, thinking, intuition, and ability to do exactly what you are doing here, but with no physical matter in you at all. When we have this body, it's controlled by the laws of the physical body. Biggest law being the law of gravity holds us here. There is no gravity holding the inner body because there's no physical matter in it. It looks so easy with the inner body to fly anywhere we like. Where would we like to fly if we have that? People say, I ask people, if you can fly inside, where would you like to fly? Oh, we'd like to fly to a new country, we'd like to fly to the galaxies, we'd like to... All physical destinations still. Nobody said, I want to fly somewhere new, which doesn't exist here. They want to fly to what they have seen outside with the physical body. That is why that inner body operates in a strange world which looks like an overlap, that there is this world also and there is another world also sitting at the same time, and we can go from one to the other. We have no physical body. All our friends can see us as nothing. We are invisible to them. They are visible to us. We have the same eyes. It looks like there is a stage we can reach by withdrawing attention from the physical body, where we can be in touch with this physical world and another world, the astral world. Why is it called the astral body and the astral world? Because the astral refers to a sky. We have a sky here. This sky, depending on this position of the sun and the earth, creates days and nights. Inner sky does not create days and nights. Inner sky, the light itself is situated in such a way, it's always lit up, and everything that you will see with that body is lit up. It has everything as its own light, like it's radiant. And that is why we all become radiant beings. That means we can be seen in what would look like utter darkness. But there is no utter darkness in that state. So light plays an important role, and that is why it looks different than this world, because this world is based upon days and nights, and that has irregular twilight zone or something that is not very bright, but is not dark. And we'll see it all the time. Everything can be seen 24/7 like that. Now these are experiences anybody can have. It's not unique, somebody can come and have it. We are all equipped the same way. There is no difference of a perfect living master who has achieved the highest levels of realization inside and ourselves. We are built the same way, same potential, same everything. There's no difference when we sit with life, mind, sense perception body, and the physical body. We're all intact the same way. No discrimination has been made. Does not matter what the color of your skin is, where you belong, what language you speak, where do you live, where you were born. Nothing matters so long as you are a human being that can think. We are all the same. And that is why what I'm talking of is open to everybody, not any particular person. The inner body of sense perceptions, which we call the astral body, gives us a lot of insight into the possibilities of what can happen. How did we reach that state? A very simple process. The process of withdrawing our attention to ourself. Can we still do it anymore? Of course. If we can do it with physical body, we can also do it with astral body. It has a head. It has eyes, though without matter. Just like this. But it's not made of matter. Supposing we were to now withdraw our attention from the astral self, the third eye center of the astral self, what would happen? We'd become unaware of sense perceptions, which will show that the whole astral body, the inner body, is made up of nothing else but sense perceptions. It has nothing else in it. Some people think it has some subtle matter or something. No, subtle matter is created by the sense perceptions. There's no matter. The matter is only here. It looks like subtle matter because we can still operate in an overlap of the physical and the astral. That is why it looks like subtle matter. Now, when we are able to withdraw our attention from the astral self, the same process, the same simple, straightforward process of withdrawing your attention to your own self at the third eye center of the astral body, you become unaware of sense perceptions, but you open up to a being of yourself, which you find created everything that you see here. It's your mind. They call it the causal body, which causes all experiences to take place. Nothing has been created here which has not been created by our own causal body, just a projection coming from there, that there are outside worlds that we can go and we are only a small part of it. Everything is coming from the causal body. And people have sometimes said that is their true home because nothing has been created except from there. People have worshipped that, worshipped the creative power there as the ultimate God, and that place as our ultimate home. Many masters have said so. And there is nothing more that you can do than this by the power of concentrating attention, because the power to concentrate attention is a mental process. You have used your mind to its capacity to reach the causal plane and discover wonderful things. And if I mention a few, they startle you. We will find out how destinies are being manufactured and how we are who we are in this body. How we were born somewhere, how we live somewhere, how the karma works. Everything is created there. The law of karma operates from there. Destinies are manufactured there. We pick up our destiny from there and play it out like a DVD, and these worlds are created for us. All that can be personally examined, reviewed, experienced by any one of us. That's the capacity of our mind and the power of concentrated attention. Attention and mind take us there. But that's the limit. Perfect living masters like great masters picture you see here, Baba Sawan Singh, he said, that is not our true home. That's the home of our mind. And the mind has trapped us here. Because so long as we are in mind, we are in time and space. Time and space are being created there at the causal plane. And then we live through it to every other plane. Therefore, we are still trapped in the biggest trap. The biggest trap that is keeping us here forever, not even giving us any information about our true home, is the trap of time, which then creates space. You will see that how it is creating. Time is creating space at the causal plane, and time and space are creating the whole astral plane, and that time and space are creating the whole physical experience. Destiny is manufactured in the causal plane, are being played out as our life here. Law of karma, creating cause and effect, and placing events upon time and space are all being created from there. It's the whole show. And we are trapped here forever. How can we get out? Now, I'm talking of somebody who can go within on his power of own, with a little bit of guidance, which can be found in the books. Then you can meditate the way I'm explaining. Anybody can do it. And if you do it long enough and correctly enough, you can get these experiences. Where is the role of a third party, a perfect living master in all this? The truth is, anybody can go there without a master. Of course, we don't know how to withdraw attention. We don't know how to stabilize ourselves with these experiences. So we get guidance from outside, but the journey is our own. Where does a perfect living master's role come into this at all? Here we have become enlightened. We have come to our true place where everything has been born and created. Where is the perfect living master's role? No role. His role comes after that. His role comes beyond the mind. His role comes where mind does not work. And what is that? Now that is where we have to understand that there are two things in our consciousness and not one. It's not mind, it's mind and soul. This distinction has to be remembered, because now I'm going to talk about the soul. That we have a soul that gives us life. There's a soul that is life. No life, no soul, no soul, no life. No matter whether it's an ant or a tree or the human being. You need a soul for life. Soul does not belong to time and space. Soul comes from beyond time and space. And that soul lies beyond the realm of everything I've talked about up to the mind. But it makes the mind alive. Soul gives life to the mind. Soul creates the causal plane. Soul creates the astral plane. Soul creates the physical plane. Soul creates our living experiences of everything, whether outside or inside. Soul is our self. Soul is the real self, not the mind. And soul lies beyond the mind. And we don't experience our soul. But actually we do, every day. We don't realize. When we try to realize, it becomes mind, because then we think how to realize. An intuitive awareness that comes suddenly, gut knowledge, comes from the soul, not from the mind. Because we don't think, it just comes. What comes without time and space, without thinking, is from the soul. Three things come from there, maybe four. Most important is the experience of love that we have here. Mind cannot create it, senses cannot create it, physical body cannot create it. Soul does. Love is a spiritual experience, no matter where it is, what kind it is. Love is not a mental thing. There's a copy of love at the mental level. It's called attachment. We get attached to things, mind desires something, mind likes something, gets attached to it. Mental attachment looks like love, but it's not love. There's one fundamental difference between love and attachment. When you are attached, you know you and the thing to which you are attached, the person to whom you are attached. Consciousness holds both together. If you're attached to a house, I love my house. I know the house, I love my house. I love that person. I am aware of I am available of that person. This is attachment. In attachment, you will always have a feeling of two, no matter how close togetherness is created between the two, still two. In love, you think of the beloved, you think of what you are loving, and forget yourself. I was once trying to see that in everything the mind's I-ness, ego, comes front. Anything we do in this world, I am going to meditate, I am going to do this, I have learned this thing. I doesn't go away at all. The mind asserts itself. The ego is the face of the mind, it's the front part of the mind, which it always projects first. We can't do anything without I. And therefore, is there some experience where you don't think of I? Love. You think of the beloved, and I somehow is not that important. The stronger the love, the less awareness you have of the I. I have not found any other thing in this physical world or any astral other world which could put the I at the back burner except love. Love puts the I, the back burner. I becomes less important, beloved becomes more important. The nature of love. Second function of the soul, intuition, where you can get knowledge, awareness without thinking. Third function, an appreciation of what you might call beautiful, you might call good. And appreciation comes from there because appreciation does not require your thinking or words about it. You appreciate and then you use your mind to express it in words. This appreciation is connected with a state of happiness, a state of being. It is more than happiness because happiness can be compared or contrasted with unhappiness. It's a pair of opposite. But that state, with the appreciation overwhelms you with love, has been used a different word they call bliss, blissful state. A blissful state is part of the soul. So the blissful state giving you the power to appreciate beauty and to be have awarenesses that do not come from thinking, and the experience of love that takes the eye behind all spiritual experiences of the soul. Are we having them right here? But we don't put any attention on them. We put more attention on what we can think. We have identified ourselves, our soul, with the mind. We have locked them together. We have locked them so tight that when we want to say, am I not the mind has to think, am I not? We're dependent on the mind. We have become totally dependent. Now comes the role of a perfect living master. What does he do? He comes to pull our soul with love. Period. No other role. He's not come to teach anything. There are plenty of teachers, millions of teachers. Very few perfect living masters. Teachers can take you what you can be taught and what you can practice. But you can't be pulled out of the mind except by love and the purest, finest kind of love. Totally unconditional. No resemblance to attachment comes from such a human being we call a perfect living master. The role of a perfect living master is very different. Great master used to say, his job starts from above the mind and ends in our true home, Sachkhand, true home. What's the difference between above the mind and our true home? Above the mind, we discover our soul, which means what is life? Consciousness intact without thinking, without any other paraphernalia of the lower regions, that we can discover that our soul. That's the journey that starts, the spiritual journey starts from the soul. Not from here. There's a mental journey. Spiritual journey starts from the soul and goes to our true home, where there's only one. All souls become one. They are one and many at the same time because there's no time. Somebody written to me this morning, you have said in one of your talks that at the top we become one. That must be terribly lonely. I don't want to follow this path. I love my company here. At least I have many I can share with them. And now you're saying, do all this stuff to go inside and become one? I haven't sent a reply. But the reply is simply, it's not one, it's total. There's nothing outside of it. All that we're experiencing here, and all we're experiencing at the astral stage, all we're experiencing at the causal stage, all we experience when we are souls, is all intact there. It's not one. The origin of all this is one consciousness, total consciousness. Everything is within that. What is the actual experience if you go there? The actual experience is not that you have come away from somewhere into oneness, that you carried the whole experience of everything ever created with you, and that's part of you, which is the truth. You discover the truth. Nothing is missed out. When we are here and go on a spiritual path, we go stage by stage. If we have a lower level of experience, which looks lower than the wakeful state, dreaming. When we dream, we are unaware of the body. Otherwise, not a real dream. It's daydream then. Real dream is when we leave our body and are moving in another body, a dream body. A dream body, if you notice, is the same self that's in the wakeful body. It's not somebody else. The self will remain the same no matter where you are, what form you take. Right from the dream, wakeful, astral, self never changes. Everything else changes except the self. The experiencer of all this never changes. That's the truth. That's the only truth. Everything else changes. But the self never changes. And we call it the self. And because at different times we apply the word self to our form. The dream body is the self. When we wake up, this is the self. Go higher up, that is the self. When we are total, that's the self. The self never changes. That is why it is said, find yourself, you'll find everything. You'll find God. If you find yourself, it's all included in that. Now, when the self goes into dream body, we are not aware of physical body. And we're running around to places. Sometimes you can even feel that you are dreaming. I had a few dreams like that when I was very young, that I could feel I am dreaming and I'm sleeping somewhere and I have to go back there to wake up. So I would run in the dream and wake up. When I wake up, I find I never went anywhere. The going away somewhere was part of the dream. Do you know? We never go anywhere. We are all the time in our true home. And these are a series of dreams. And they are creating like they are real. We can wake up from one to the other. When we wake up from a dream state, we know we were in the same bed. The whole thing happened while our physical body was still there. What will happen if we really go not in the overlap of the astral physical, but go to the pure astral, we'll find we were always there. It was just like a dream that we had a physical world and a physical life. Just the same way. We go to the next higher level, we woke up, we were always there. And we just had a sleep or a dream and created an astral world. We go to the soul just had a dream to create time and space and have a different experience. We were always there. We go to our true home, we never left our true home. The whole show took place there. So imagine, the true home had the whole experience total. It's not that you are lonely or alone. You are more created company of the entire creation with you. In your true home, the entire thing has happened there, nowhere else. And there's no other place to have. Place is created from there. Everything is created from there. So there's no loneliness there at all. It's a very different experience. But when we start from here, like we wake up from a dream and physical body becomes real, we wake up to the next level, the physical body looks like a dream body and that becomes real. But we can hold only one reality at one time. This creation is so beautiful, so wonderful, because we have been able to create reality. Not illusion. not a shadow. They are all real. How did we become real? How do we become real in the dream? A dream is going on. If we are not awake at all, the dream looks like reality. We wake up, it becomes a dream. A dream is not a dream while you are dreaming. A dream is a dream when you wake up. This is reality till you wake up to a higher level. Then it becomes dream, not then. How are we able to create reality? Not just a show, not just a drama, but a reality in which we are real people. We create it by shutting off the experience of wakefulness. We have to shut that off to make the dream real. We have shut our own reality in order to create a reality wherever we want to create it, including physical reality, astral reality, causal reality, ultimate reality, spiritual reality. We create realities, and we do it in a wonderful way. And I'll tell you how we create this physical reality. As I explained in the beginning, we create physical reality by using sense perceptions to know the world. And to know if it is real or not, we use the divided sense perceptions, which means seeing is different. I see this table. Is it real or not? I can touch it. Yes, it is real. I am using one perception to test the other and call it real. When all of them are the same, I can do the same thing in a dream. Supposing in a dream I see a table, I say, am I dreaming? Or is it real? I touch the table. No, it's real. I can touch it. And I wake up, neither table was there. It was not created by me. That is why reality is being created by our checking reality. We are given a definition of reality. It should match the other sense perceptions. And they all operate at the same level of wakeful state or dream state or higher wakeful state. It's a beautiful way. If you look at the way this creation has taken place from a little higher angle, you'll be amazed how perfect it is. How much perfection has gone into the creation of realities of different levels. When somebody comes to me and says, oh, I have found out this is all illusion. I remember once a sadhu came to the Dera, great master Dera, and Satsang was over, great master had gone home. He's sitting on a platform telling, he's been to Sachkhand, he's been everywhere, boasting about it. I was a little child. And he was talking, oh, it's all illusion. Yes. So I somehow had a safety pin. You know, must have tied up a hanky or something. So I opened up the safety pin. And while he was chatting about high levels, I just pinched him. I poked him. He was, oh, angry, got up. I said, where's the illusion? And I ran. He ran after me. He left the crowd. And I said, a little safety pin can create reality for you. And some philosophers have said, what is really creating reality for in the physical world is pain. When pain comes, it becomes real. No matter how much you say it's very unreal, it's all illusion, it's all maya, it's all this thing. It's no longer maya when a little pain comes. In a play, Shakespeare says, there never yet was philosopher who could bear the toothache patiently. He could say everything is unreal, illusion, and when the teeth were paining, it's real. Pain makes it real. A big role pain is playing in our lives. And we can have physical pain, we can have emotional pain, we can have spiritual pain, we can have pain at all levels. And make everything real. And then we test reality. Look at the wonderful way this has been set up, that we create levels of realities, not levels of illusion. But what with the process we use could be called the process of using illusion. It could be called like that because there is no absolute reality outside of ourselves. The self creates experiences which look absolutely real. And that's a wonderful thing. But the truth remains that when we wake up, we discover that what we saw outside was actually inside. Whether it's from a dream you wake up, the dream was inside. Never, there was no dreamland outside. But you can go into a dream. You can go into a dream and see an old mansion. And you have never been there. And you ask somebody, how old is this mansion? This is 3,000 years old. You look at it, it is 3,000 years old. And you can remember other structures that were constructed, and you wake up. Neither is the mention there, nor 3,000 years. Imagine by creating a little sequence, you can create time, unlimited time, and space. You can have a dream, you're looking into the stars, suddenly see new stars. Say, wonderful, I never knew this. And you wake up, the stars were in your head, not outside anywhere. This very experience goes on as you awaken to higher states and discover that truth lies in the totality of consciousness, which is ourself. And everything comes from there. The reality is ourself. Anybody who has gone to the self has discovered the reality of everything, including God or the Creator. I am sharing these things with you because it's a most miraculous thing that one can, while an ordinary human being living an ordinary destiny created here, rich, poor, or anywhere, still has the ability to find all this truth within oneself. And we seek that. Sometimes the seeking comes very strangely inside. The mind is seeking outside things, and something inside is seeking, I want to know the real thing. Why am I here? Why is this happening? What is life? What is this? Why do I hear religion speak of this? I've been brought up in a religion. Most of us are brought up in different religions. Why did religion speak of God being there? Where is God? All kinds of things come to us and make us seek something. Mind is not interested in the seeking. Something else in us is actually the soul. The soul is seeking its truth. Soul is seeking its true home. And when you seek the true home, a perfect living master appears in your life. You can't find him. You can never find a perfect living master, because if somebody comes and says, I am a master, he is governed by his mind. His ego is very strong. And forget it. A perfect living master appears like ourselves. No difference. Born like us, lives like us, destiny like us, everything like us, except his love which pulls us. The love pulls us in such an unconditional way. Every other love seems to have some conditions. Somebody loves you, you say, I hate you. The love converts into hatred. This love of a perfect living master, and I'm telling you, after my experience with the perfect living master, is totally unconditional. There's no judgment in it. Be a good person, I will love you. No way. I love you because you are a seeker. You have sought the truth. And a perfect living master appears. He appears like an ordinary person, becomes a friend. There was a great disciple of his, Dr. Ishwar Singh. I tell many stories of him. And he, towards the last stage of his life, said, I now realize a perfect living master is a friend first, master afterwards. The first beginning is like a friend. And if you're not a friend, then he's just a picture of a master. Something that we worship. We worship an idol, we worship a statue, we can worship a man. No difference. But there's a friend, a personal friend who can hold our hand. And then we find that his love is unconditional. Where is it coming from? Why? And it connects with your seeking. And it's the love that pulls us beyond the mind. He takes us beyond the mind. But our mind needs to be taught. Our mind needs instructions. Our mind needs to be put everything in order. So temporarily, a perfect living master becomes a teacher. He's not come to teach. But he becomes a teacher like other teachers and begins to say, do this, do that, mind loves that. There are 5 stages of going through. They're placed one above the other. You will fly from one stage to other. In truth, it's all nonsense. I must confess. There are no stages one above the other. They're all within each other. And nothing is outside. As you go deeper and deeper into your own self, the stages appear. But the mind doesn't like that. The mind says, yeah, one above the other. We go higher and higher. There's something up there. I see people praying to God up in the sky. I try to look at the sky. I say, where is he hiding in the sky, in a physical sky? We are confusing ourselves by the mind. Want to put everything outside. Look outside. And then, of course, when we look outside, then why should we look at a man and look for a master? We should not. We should look inside. If you look inside, a person appears outside. Created by who? If I am saying the whole world is being created by the self, who can create a master? The same self. Who is a master? What is the real reality of a perfect living master who appears as an ordinary human being in our life? Reality is, he's our own self created outside because we don't look inside. Very simple. And he creates conditions. Within outside can create conditions which pull us inside, and the pull is inside. And when we withdraw attention of a perfect living master's presence, which we see outside, withdraw attention, radiant form is still inside. You go to the causal plane, still a friend, still inside. You go to spiritual level, he's still inside. You go to totality, he's part of ourselves, he's still inside. He's not an ordinary human being, comes as an ordinary human being. But only through our own inner experiences we discover why he came into our life, because of our seeking. Therefore, the secret is to seek inside. You seek inside by coincidence, by chance, a perfect living master will appear outside. These coincidences play a big role in a life. I'll talk to you a little bit more in the afternoon. I understand there are many of you who have come for the first time and liked a few minutes of personal conversation with me. They have set apart some time for that. This is an exercise where you use your attention. And the attention could go any part of your body. It only demonstrates how easy it is to move your attention. And therefore, when you put your attention behind the eyes, you hold it at the eye level and you figure out where are you holding attention from, and it begins to get you there. The second way of holding attention at the third eye center is to merely imagine you are there. Not try to see or do anything. You imagine you are there and you can feel the whole head around you, you can feel the whole body around you. You can feel you are there. No idea what shape you are till you see you have got hands. You are not looking at yourself, you are just feeling you are there and you are looking at your hands. Then you can do it. This first step is very crucial to effective meditation, because people do not do that and they just close their eyes, they remain in the physical consciousness. You can even get sleepy. A lot of people sleep during meditation and they have a little dream sequence, and so they have just gone into dream state, but they have not held their attention in a wakeful state at the third eye center. So this is to wake up higher, not to go back to no sleep. So that is why it's very important to practice this. Doesn't matter how long it takes, it's important before you go to the next step. All the planes are there with us all the time. It's a question of where we put attention in our awareness. And that is why it's an important thing to know that the whole discovery of the reality and ultimate reality and our true home is going to be found right here, nowhere else. There is no place except here. There is no time except now. Now is creating past and future. Now is creating all the sense of time. We are never outside of now. Yet somebody said, they wrote a book and sent me, that you must live in the now. Where else are we living? My question was very simple. I want to meet a person who doesn't live in the now. What is really meant by saying live in the now is, do not spend your time and your attention on the past or too much on the future. But if you have to make a choice, my recommendation is spend time on the future, nothing on the past. But we've spent so much time on the past and make our lives miserable. We feel guilty. Oh, we could have done this better. You can't change it. Your feeling sorry for something that happened will not change it. The only usefulness of the past is very temporary when you learn a lesson from it. And by the way, you learn that lesson whether you like it or not. We have learnt our lessons from past lives. They come automatically. We have burnt in a past life, we are afraid of fire in this one. We fell from a height, we are afraid of heights now. We learn the lessons automatically, they are built into us. So no use going into the past. What is over. That is why live in what is happening around us and what you can achieve in the future. When you make your imagination strong enough, and I'll talk about willpower, spiritual will and mental will. Use spiritual will, whatever you imagine will become reality. So much power you have right inside. So these are very interesting facts that you can find inside yourself. While, when I come back, I'll come after a longish period of lunch that we give you to enjoy your food. When I come back, if you have any questions on what we have talked about, do we have arrangement to write them down? If they have some pieces of paper, you write them down, and I'll take up your questions. You can ask questions on what I have spoken now. You can also ask questions on what I have not spoken, but what is in your head. And if I know the answer, I'll give you. If I have to search for the answer, I will tell you, I'll search for it and give you tomorrow. I'll search for it all night. Sometimes people ask me questions, I search. I remember there was a friend of mine in India. We were both initiated about the same time by great master, Baba Sawan Singh. He was very wonderful disciple. He meditated regularly and he followed the rules about diet, to be vegetarian and led a very nice moral life. He followed whatever he could to be on a spiritual path, on a right path. And we grew up, great master died. Many other masters came of different lineages, not necessarily belonging to the same group. So many masters claimed to be all coming from the great master's teachings. But he was so good, he had a nice house in a town called Ludhiana in Punjab in India. And he had a workshop, a foundry, a little factory behind the house. And he had a nice big lawn, so many discourses were held by the masters, including one by great master himself, who went to his house and gave a discourse to a small group. So he was a very well-known person in the spiritual field in our friends, satsangi friends. So I took one of my friends from America. I had already shifted here. I took one of my friends and he wanted to see some good disciples, if they are still living, of great master. I took him to one, Dr. Ishwar Singh, then I took him to this man. Now he's passed away, so I can tell you the name of Hira Singh. So Hira Singh's house, I took him, and one of the current masters was giving a discourse at that time. And they had put up a tent and they raised a nice kind of stage for him. So master was talking from there. And I and my American friend, we went and we stood at the back. So master somehow saw us and he called us like this. So I went up and said, "Master, you finish your discourse and I brought a friend who would like to talk to you." Master said, "Satsang finished," and got up. My friend was very impressed at my power to persuade a master to finish satsang just when he arrived. Anyway, we went inside and I met many old friends and many new friends, and they began to ask me questions about America. They asked me questions about the disciples in America, and some began to ask about spiritual questions. So I was giving them answers, and Hira Singh came to me, the host. And he said, "I have a question to ask you." I said, "Certainly. What is it, Hira Singh?" He said, "I want to know that you and I are both initiates of the same master." He said, "I don't know about you, but I have meditated 2.5 hours regularly after my initiation. And I have followed the vegetarian diet as prescribed. I have led a very nice moral life, being very careful not to do anything wrong which would displease my master. So I have followed this path. It's now almost 45 years since we were initiated. 40 or 45 years. I'm telling you an older story. And it appears that I saw nothing in my meditation. And appears you have seen something the way you answer questions. I said, I don't know if I've seen something or not. Maybe I just remember great master teachings and I, like a parrot, speak them out. But why haven't you got your more regular than me, I can tell you, in your meditation, in the way you live your life? I haven't lived that pure life like you have. I lived a very ordinary, common life. But great master blessings I can feel. How come this happened to you? He said, that's what I want to know from you. How, what is the discrimination? That I, who followed the path clearly, did not get anything, and you say you didn't follow that clear, that well as I did, got something. I said, I want to tell you a secret. The secret is, when people ask me questions, I don't answer them. I check with my master. They are really great master's answers. Because whatever he says, I tell. So don't give me any credit for the question I'm answering. Give credit to our master, who is helping me in this to give the answers. He says, all right, then check with your master. Check with our master. Why did I not make any progress internally? I said, okay, I will check. He said, check now. I said, master is not that free to be available all the time. I have to make an appointment inside and then convey your question. It takes time. He says, how long will it take to get an answer to my question? I said, normally it will take about 6 months. He said, 6 months? I didn't even thought it'll take 6 minutes. I said, no, he's a very busy master. You don't know what he's doing in different regions. Now, I must confess to you today, I said 6 months because I was going to make my next trip to India in 6 months. A little cheating, you know. But anyway, I said, wait for 6 months and I'll give you the answer. But I said, before I go, do you know great master visited your house? Why didn't you ask him this? Same question, when he was alive. He said, I did ask him. Master, I'm doing all this meditation, but I haven't seen anything. What answer did he give? He said, he smiled and said, continue your meditation with love and devotion. I said, then many other masters have come into your house. Why couldn't you ask them? More time has passed and you're not getting any experiences. Why not? He said, I asked other masters also. What did they say? They smiled and said, continue your meditation with love and devotion. Same thing. I said, I'll get the answer in 6 months and tell you. I came back to America. My friend was also intrigued, American friend, that what is this conversation going on? I explained to him the question, and I have to find an answer in 6 months. 6 months I went back. I went back to Hira Singh's house and met him. Got your answer. He said, what is the answer? He says, great master says, in a very smiling way, do your meditation with love and devotion. The same answer he gave you earlier. He says, how come he's giving the same answer? He says, because you didn't listen to the answer in the first place. That's what's giving it again. He said, but I heard it. I said, you heard, do your meditation. You forget the last words, few words, with love and devotion. The whole secret is love and devotion. Meditation done mechanically for saying, let me see what I can find, doesn't work on this spiritual path. Meditation with love and devotion, response. Why do we use two words, love and devotion? Love is experienced by us. Our reaction is automatic, which is called devotion. That's why it's love and devotion. When love touches us, we automatically become devotees. And that love and devotion, if it's kept in mind, how do we express our love and devotion? How do we experience? The way we would do now, at least be thankful. Look at what Master does, and every day you can feel, this couldn't have happened but for Master. This couldn't have happened but for grace. Every day we feel it. Do we thank Master? Do we express gratitude in meditation? Or do we just meditate to put our attention there? Or do we talk to our Master? We should talk to our Master, express love for him, tell him what has happened, have a conversation with him. That's how good meditation takes place. Try it. Try now. I'll come again in 6 months. I have to get a report from you. I went in again after 6 months and met him. He said he made more progress in 6 months than he made in 40 years, just with this little tip. One should never forget, this is a path of love and devotion. Meditation is a means to take care of the mind. Meditation, no matter what meditation, of any kind, and I've tried several kinds of meditation in my young days. They are all mental exercises. They're no spiritual exercise. The only spiritual exercise is love and devotion. Love and devotion is beyond the mind. All other attempts and struggles and work is with the mind. Whenever we want to do something, it's the mind that does it. Meditation is only there. Somebody asked me a very simple question, that there is a master saying, why are you taking 5 words as your mantra, as your simran? Those 5 words represent 5 levels of consciousness. And we are tying ourselves to lower levels of consciousness by using 3 words of the physical astral causal. We should only use the 2 top words. And this happened when I was also young, and somebody was telling me this. And he said, ever since I discovered that this is a division between Kal and Dyal, between the negative power and positive power, these 3 words are negative power. The top 2 words are positive power. We should use 2 words only for the top and not these words which belong to the negative power. I said, I'll check with my master. I'll get Master was alive. I went to him. I said, a friend of mine is complaining, why are you saying repeat 5 words which represent 5 levels of awareness? We should repeat 2, which are spiritual words. He said, if I put a ladder against that wall and you want to go up, will you go only on the top 2 or you'll start from the bottom? Simple answer. That is like a ladder. You have to go through the region of the negative power. You have to go through this region. Therefore, we use these words just to indicate that this is the step we are taking. That's all. So when I gave the answer, he went reverted back from 2 words to 5 words. More recently, somebody now told me that in one of the spiritual books, it says all these 5 words belong to the negative power. What do you say? I said, that's right. He said, what about 2 words which are spiritual? I said, no spiritual word. There's no spiritual language. Language is all in the 3 worlds. When there's no language in the higher world, what mantra can you talk of which is beyond the mind? Languages are all limited here. They are all for this place. Language is spoken only in 2 regions, the physical plane and the astral plane. There's no language after that. People say, and they have different interpretations. I'm just sharing with you something that come to my notice again and again. People say that these different practices that we have, repeating the mantras and so on, they are the true shabd, the word. You know, it has been said in Shri Guru Granth Sahib, says that shabd created everything. Shabd dharti, shabd akash, and so on. Everything created by shabd. And at the end it says, the translation is that everything created by the sky and the sun, everything created by the sound, the shabd. And Shabde Shabdhya Prakash. Even Shabd was created by Shabd. Shabd is word, sound, whatever. The Bible, John's Gospel, begins with the opening sentences. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. People say, has God been described anywhere? I said, yes, in the Bible. John's Gospel says very clearly what God is. In the beginning was the Word, not God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Very clear definition. The word, shabd, again. Now when we examine these different texts, the Rig Veda in India, one of the oldest scriptures available, says that this world was created by Nard, the sound. Almost a translation from the John's Gospel. It's almost the same words. What is the meaning? I looked up a dictionary, Columbia American English Dictionary, to see what do they say about the word with capital W. They said word means the Bible. It's actual translation given there. Other places they say the word means a granth or a book or the Vedas, all referring to something that is physical, that exists here. And how could something that exists here be the creative power that created everything? It's a bigger, big mistake to think that the reference to the sound or the word or this is referring to something here. The path that great master teaches has often been called Surt Shabd Yoga. What it means is Surt is attention, Shabd, sound, Yoga, union with your total self. That means put your attention on the sound and you reach there, or the word that you reach there. What kind of sound and word can it be that can take you all the way up? So the whole idea that this word means either something, a book or a treatise or a spoken word or something, is unreal. This word is necessary at every level. That's true. The words I am speaking to you now are physical words. They're very in a simple language. These physical words, I am speaking in English language, which most of you understand. Some are trying to understand what it is, but anyway, that's a different matter. But this is a language I could speak in a different language many of you won't understand. Some will. These words I am speaking are called Varan Atmak Shabd. That means word that can be spoken and written. That has to be the beginning of our spiritual exercise. If we don't hear anything about it in the physical plane as physical bodies, how will we start? So there's a big role to be performed by spoken and written words. The books, the spoken words, they come in at the beginning of our journey to our own self. That is why there's an importance of the beginning words. But what happens when we withdraw our attention to the astral plane? We can still use the words, but we don't need to. In the astral plane, the mind in the astral self works differently. It works through what we physically call telepathy. Telepathy means you think something other person understands. That's a normal way of understanding each other at the astral plane. It's a normal way. And you notice a very interesting thing. In telepathic communication, you are not conveying words. You are conveying the meaning of words. Supposing you have a friend in Germany who doesn't know English, and you think of something in English that person understands telepathically in German. The translation happens automatically, so no longer bound down by the laws of the language here. So freed from the word, it becomes different. So those words are different. That shabd becomes a different kind of shabd. It's the sound that, if you want to hear, with your ears, it's like sound. Here we are hearing the spoken word with our ears, there we hear the word spoken, and that looks like sound. And sound can be heard. You can hear it even now by putting attention inside, and you can hear it all the time when you are there. So that is why they consider that sound, not spoken now,
So the varnatmak shabd or the spoken shabd becomes dhunatmak shabd, which means the sound like a music. It becomes music. That's a wonderful transformation. Then what happens? Supposing you withdraw your attention from the astral plane and go over to the causal plane. What happens to the sound? Sound changes. The sound here, the spoken words, are starting when I begin talking and the end when I stop talking. The telepathic language that is used in the astral plane starts when you start telepathy and ends when you stop. When you go to causal plane, a sound is there which it appears to you, you have been hearing all the time. It's not that you started hearing when you were there, that you've always been hearing it. That's the first thing that happens. So that is why the varanatmak shabd, spoken language, becomes dhunatmak shabd, becomes a music, and from music it becomes anhad shabd, one that has no beginning and no end. You can feel it as an experience, not just by description. And what happens after that? Then you leave the three regions that become, you can't describe it because there's no space and time there, but simple way of describing it, it's called sar shabd, which means the true sound, which is your own self. There you discover it is yourself. That what you are hearing here is also yourself. What you hear inside is also yourself. What you hear in the next region is also yourself. In your true home, we call it Sat Shabd, a true sound, which is totality of everything, still sound. That is where the meaning of the word has been used in all the scriptures. And we fail to realize we are talking of something of the self and consciousness. We are talking of totality of consciousness when we say the word. Anyway, I'm sharing these things with you because you can all find the truth of this insight. The beauty of the spiritual path as taught by this great master is it can all be verified by personal experience and not by belief. There is no scope for blind faith or blind belief in this system. Believe what you experience. If you experience little, believe that. But don't disbelieve the rest because you haven't experienced. That's another fault we have, that if we don't experience, it doesn't exist. Somebody else may have an experience, we say, no, I didn't have it, therefore it doesn't exist. No, it may exist. You believe what you see. When you believe more, then you believe more, then you have more experience. Go with your experience. Your belief should depend upon your personal experience. And as experiences grow, belief grows. So real faith is a living faith. It grows like living things. Blind faith is dead. Because blind you, somebody said something, you believe it, never grows. It's just dead. So this path, spiritual path, which I'm sharing with you, is a living faith. It grows with your experience, both external and internal. So I'll be very happy to see you again after this lunch break. And if you have paper and pencil available to write any question during lunch hour, you can bring them, then I'll talk to you about your questions. And any question you can ask, I'll try to answer. Some of them may require 6 months, I'll let you know that. Thank you very much.